on Continental Championship Wrestling this coming week. Also, on this hour, the Continental Heavyweight Championship goes on the line. Brad Armstrong defending that title against Kevin Sullivan, the Mystic One. You'll also be seeing the Bullet and Steve Armstrong in action. And a host of other great events upcoming during this next hour. So by all means, do stay tuned. Right now, though, we have an outstanding match upcoming, announcing the return of the Hustler Rip Rogers and his valet, Miss Brenda Britton. So let's turn it over to Freddie Miller.
Thank you, Gordon. Ladies and gentlemen, this event, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Now in the ring at 244 pounds from St. Louis, Missouri, here's Tony Falk. Tony Falk. His opponent, ladies and gentlemen, now entering the ring to his music, the return to Alabama of Miss Britton, Brenda Britton, the valet for the Hustler, Rip Rogers. Here's Brenda Britton, Brenda Britton. And ladies and gentlemen, from Los Angeles, California, at 230 pounds, here's the Hustler, Rip Rogers, Rip Rogers.
Okay, the Hustler, Rip Rogers, now in the lavender trunks.
Rip has something to say to the crowd. Let's turn this microphone over to him on Continental Championship Wrestling.
Watch this man compete for a long, long time. Woo, brother. Drove that right hand into the side of the jaw. Didn't allow the pinfall, although Tony may have been able to get his shoulders off. He was now hurdled outside the ring. Rogers, wasting no time, goes out to catch him once again. Brings him up high, atomic knee drop outside the ring. As we mentioned, of course, the Tennessee Stud will be returning to Continental Championship Wrestling next week. Rip Rogers, a headbutt to the side of the head. So Tony's in trouble, and Rogers drives him into that second ring rope. And, and there's Miss Brenda Britton, taking some extra advantage there. By the way, a lot of people have a bit of a habit of calling her Fleabag, and I have been informed by the Hustler, Rip Rogers, please do not call her Fleabag. And I personally would become very upset if you were to do that in the arena. Yes, you get my drift. Body slam by the Hustler, Rip Rogers. And again, Rogers does not allow the pinfall. Rogers very much in charge of the situation. High vertical souffle by Rogers. You can see the evidence of the kind of physical training this man has undergone. Finally, you started concentrating on trouble here. An Irish whip and Rogers has been staggered. Tony, Rogers was a step ahead even that time. Goes to a full Boston crab. That's referee Gene Williams. As Tony conceded, he conceded, and so the hustler Rip Rogers. Wait a minute, look at Rogers. Hurdle Tony over the top rope, but he's already won the match. And so, with the official word, here's our ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, in a time of 3 minutes and 49 seconds, your winner, Hustler Rip Rogers. Rip Rogers. Who's bad, baby? There's a Southeastern champion around here that's hiding behind the coattails of the Bullet. What I'm talking about is, where is Adrian Street?
You're asking where Adrian Street is located. Mr. Rogers and Miss Brenda, he and Miss Linda are right here. You're obviously ignorant and you don't know what all these people, what all our fans know. The reason I have defended this title for about 4 weeks is the fact that I've been doing something, as far as I'm concerned, is more important. I came down to help, not hide behind the Bullet. As far as we're concerned, we've been partners, and we've had our plates full. But if you want some of this, all you gotta do is ask. Anybody that wants to go this title, all they gotta do is ask it, a share. And by the way, which one of you is a flea bag?
Oh, which one is the flea bag? And I'll tell you what.
Rip Rogers and his horse Trigger.
Wait just a minute now. The hustler Rip Rogers making his way to the podium.
Let me tell you something, Street. I've been a champion everywhere I've been. You're nothing. That belt belongs to me. I'm the real Southeastern heavyweight champion. You're a girl, because I'm a man, baby.
Whereby you come 3,000 miles, I'll tell you something, brother, you come 3,000 miles for nothing.
Hey, hold on, we'll be back. We'll be back. We've got to get order restored. We'll be right back. We'll be back. Go there.
Thank you, Gordon. Adrian, what about what happened to Miss Linda with this Rip Rogers, the hustler?
He just showed his true colors right from the off. You're on about, you came 3,000 miles from California. I came 3,000 miles across the Atlantic. I'm the champion. These people know I'm the champion. There's no way I'm hiding behind anybody. If you came for it, here it is. Come and get it. Come and get the belt if you want it. There's no way. There's no way you'll ever lay your hand on Miss Linda again. The Fleabag Sisters. If you want it, come and get it. Rip Rogers and his horse Trigger.
Let me tell you something, Street. Fleabag. And that thing behind you. And all you people better not call anybody any names. I'm telling you, Street, you put that Southeastern belt up just one time. Just one time, baby. And I'll add it to my big collection of national heavyweight champion, Florida champion, Texas champion, Alabama champion, you name it, every champion I've ever been. Put it on the line, baby. It'll be mine. And if you're Miss What's-Your-Name, will take care of her.
Ladies and gentlemen, this tag team event, one fall with a 15-minute time limit. Let's welcome back from Montgomery, Alabama, a popular wrestler in professional wrestling, Burrhead Jones. Burrhead Jones. His team partner is Wayne Spratlin. Wayne Spratlin. Now entering the ring, their opponents, accompanied by Kevin Sullivan, at a combined weight of 495 pounds from New Guinea, here are the Headhunters. The Headhunters.
Headhunters, as usual, wasting no time charging the ring. Spratlin is the first one to be hurtled through the ropes. There's the bell, finally. And Burrhead Jones now taking a tremendous beating at the hands of the two Headhunters, brought here by Kevin Sullivan, who is known by many as the Prince of Darkness. Off the ropes, caught him with a lariat. Burrhead on the canvas now. The tag is made. And these New Guinea Headhunters are as tough a combination as I've ever seen in my life. The tag is made. Spratlin comes into the ring, but that's about as far as he gets before the Headhunters catch up with him. And the Headhunters using those chops with almost reckless abandon has him up again. Ooh! Off the top rope. And so the Headhunters have completely and totally dominated the situation. Sullivan catches him outside. And at the moment, they have no opponents. Nobody is tagged up with Burrhead. Outside the ring again after Spratlin, and Spratlin hurtled back through the ropes. You could hear that chop all the way across Boutwell Auditorium. Irish whip and another chop into the chest of Wayne Spratlin. There's that inverted power slam once again. Again, the tag is made. Watch this now as he comes over the top rope, uses his head as a battering ram. A count of three. A count of three, and Kevin Sullivan in there now trying to restrain his men, which he has to do. They're practically unmanageable. And now for the official word, here's our ring announcer.
In a time of 3 minutes, 40 seconds, here are your winners from New Guinea, the Headhunters. The Headhunters.
Viewing area. First of all, we've got Barberville on October 16th, Knoxville at the Civic Center on the 17th, and Whitley City, Kentucky on the 18th. Before I talk to Brad Armstrong about the very, very important match he has upcoming, let's turn it over to Freddie Miller.
Five title matches, a great night Friday, October 17th, the Tennessee Super Bowl, Knoxville, Tennessee. Kevin Sullivan's with me. He's in one of those big championship matches.
No, I'm not one of the big. I'm in the most important match of my career. You see, the Tennessee Stud sent me to do a job. I got the job done. Robert and Jimmy didn't. Now, his old man is hiding behind a mistake. Bob, the mistake you committed 24 years ago on some hot August night, that you have to look at it every morning when you get up, Brad's ugly face. I'm going to take care of him right there in Knoxville, just like I dropped Cooley on his head. Brad, I'm going to snap your little pigeon neck and force the old man to wrestle me. Come on, Bullet, let's see what you got.
Back to you, Gordon.
Knoxville Civic Center, the Continental title.
Continental title against Kevin Sullivan. You know, Kevin Sullivan is no stranger to the Knoxville area. I know Knoxville has had Kevin Sullivan up to here. He used to have his own television show where he had his fallen angel come out and stand with him the whole time.
Weird.
Well, he's a bizarre individual as it is, and there really is no way to prepare for a match except run yourself into walls, and that's about what Kevin Sullivan is. He's a stocky little fire hydrant, but I'm going to tell you what. I'm going to pull a plug on you, Kevin Sullivan, and I'm going to do it at the Super Bowl. There's about five or six title matches. The Continental title's up for grabs, brother, but it's not in your reach. So live with it, Kevin Sullivan. Knoxville Friday night's fall right for fighting.
All right, and that's Brad Armstrong telling you what it's all about on Friday night on the 17th in Knoxville at the Knoxville Civic Center. Continental Championship Wrestling returns to Knoxville.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match, a special 30-minute TV time limit, 30 minutes, is for the Continental Heavyweight Wrestling Championship. From Singapore, the challenger at 245 pounds, here is Kevin the Mystic Sullivan, Kevin Sullivan. Ladies and gentlemen, from Marietta, Georgia, from one of wrestling's most famous families, the current Continental Heavyweight Champion at 230 pounds, here's Brad Armstrong, Brad Armstrong. One fall with a 30-minute time limit.
Continental Championship on the line. Remember, later on, hopefully, if we have time, we're going to be seeing the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair. But look at Brad Armstrong, Continental Champion, and he's really pounding away at Kevin Sullivan. Sullivan, however, gets him an Brad Armstrong ducks away. The back of the hand, and Brad Armstrong, a beautiful standing dropkick. Kevin Sullivan, formerly of Boston, now of Singapore, outside the ring. And Brad Armstrong wasting no time. Armstrong giving away about 20 pounds. Sullivan rips across the eyes. Sullivan catches him again. Good block by Sullivan, but Armstrong connects with two right hands, a third right hand. Whip into the far turnbuckle. The walk out into a hip lock takedown by Brad Armstrong. Special hello to Janice and Nicole. Keeping him on the canvas. Him with a side headlock once again. Remember, the Continental title on the line. Sullivan outside the ring, and he's trying to slip away from Brad Armstrong. Now they're both outside the ring. Referee Roy George tolling the count. Armstrong jammed into that steel ring post, jammed into it once again. Kevin Sullivan carrying the battle outside the ring. And that one did a 360. Brad Armstrong fires back. Brad Armstrong catches him once again. Hard right hand. Sullivan back into the ring. Brad Armstrong moving in right after him. Ooh! Brad Armstrong caught by Sullivan. Brad Armstrong dropped to the canvas. Armstrong in the red trunks, and he's got problems. Sullivan, 245 pounds, built along the lines of a Sherman tank. Vertical suplex by Sullivan. Brad Armstrong powers out. And it's Sullivan missing. Brad Armstrong catches him, cross body block. Sullivan got those shoulders off before the count. To an outside cradle by Brad Armstrong. Sullivan catches him. Armstrong hurtled from the ring once again. Sullivan. Back in control, if you will. Count is on. Roy George tolling the count. Sullivan moving outside the ring, moves against Brad Armstrong. And the Irish whips him into the steel guardrail outside the ring, the outer perimeter. catches him once again. Brad Armstrong in trouble as the lumbar section of his back caught it. Again, Sullivan pressing that advantage. Brad Armstrong in a lot of trouble. Good move by Armstrong up and over his man, Meltzer. Sullivan slipped away from it and now turns the tables on Brad Armstrong. Now Sullivan punishing Armstrong. Has him in the standing crossbow. So Sullivan has everything going his way at this point in time. In trouble now as he tries to break free. The crowd picking up the chant now as the thousands jam the Boutwell Auditorium, chanting, "Go, Brad, go!" And they are solidly with young Brad Armstrong. Sullivan maintaining his dominance at this point in time. Roy George checking with Armstrong. Armstrong is not a quitter. When the going gets tough, the tough get going, and that's exactly what Armstrong is all about. The minute the going gets tough, brother, he starts to move. And that's exactly what he's doing at this point in time. Look at the way he's moving Sullivan. Sullivan has a leverage advantage here. That isn't the advantage he took. Sullivan jamming one of those powerful shoulders into the midsection of Brad Armstrong. Remember now, the Continental title on the line. One ball with a 30-minute television time limit. Armstrong fires back. Sullivan fires in retaliation. Now Sullivan uncorks a hard right hand, and that has Armstrong down. No, sir. Foot on the ropes. Sullivan punishing Armstrong. Armstrong retaliating. Armstrong turning the tables here. And it's Armstrong ducking away. Armstrong. Well, they both collided there. You could hear the crack of those skulls as they collided in midair. Armstrong back on his feet. He closes in a hard right hand on Kevin Sullivan. Armstrong now catches him with a beautiful standing drop kick. Armstrong closes in. Lateral press. And Armstrong, that adrenaline is really beginning to flow now. He is fired up. Tried to set him for a backdrop. Sullivan caught him. Pile driver. Caught him with that pile driver. We have a new Continental champion. Caught him with a karate chop to the back of the head. Then with the pile driver, it is all over. We've got a new Continental champion in Kevin Sullivan. For the official word, here's our ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, a time of 10 minutes and 5 seconds, your winner and new Continental Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, the Mystic, Kevin Sullivan. Kevin Sullivan, the winner.
Well, we do have indeed a new Continental Champion in Kevin Sullivan.
That was a beautiful win, wasn't it, Gordon?
Beautiful.
Well, the U.S. Junior Heavyweight Champion, Mr. Roy Lee Welch, has joined me, and you're very pleased, I take it.
Well, I'm very pleased that Kevin Sullivan won that title, but something I'm not pleased with is the way that I was treated by one Dr. Tom Pritchard. You got to realize that I am the champion, I am the king of wrestling, and I demand respect, not only from you, from the people, but from each and every wrestler that confronts me in that ring. Now, the first thing that happened that got me upset was walking right up to that man, and he slapped me right in the face, knocked my very expensive crown off along with my glasses. He viciously attacked me, something that I would never do to a man, and I was real disappointed in the doctor for doing that.
Well, I'll tell you what, Mr. Welch, I recognize you as the U.S. Junior Heavyweight Champion. But I think it would be very interesting, and yes, I understand that you're the, quote, king of wrestling. I think it would be very interesting, however, to take a look at the match that you're talking about, because there were a couple of things that happened that I think might be most interesting. Let's look right down here at the monitor, shall we?
I'd really like to, because Tom Pritchard did something later on in the match that we're going to see that really, really upset me. Now, he stooped to a level that I would never stoop to, Gordon. He resorted to tactics that were completely illegal. He went for a foreign object. He actually put it on his foot, and it was solid metal. I can vouch for that. And he hit me with it right upside the head.
Well, all right, let's watch very carefully. Here he misses with a right hand. You catch him with a forearm. I must say that was an excellent forearm. It was.
Thank you very much, girl.
All right, so he manages, however, to power out before the count.
Well, he did, and I don't know how he did that, because that was a very strong forearm. Now, right here, I'm adjusting my ties because I like to keep my appearance up. I am the king.
Wait just a minute now. I look at him. He's putting something
he
on his boot.
Right there.
What did you put on your fist?
No, I was straightening my tights, Gordon. Right there, he put a metal object on his foot, hit me right upside the head, and that's something that's the only way he could have beat me. You know that. That's the only way that any man could have beat me. To go to tactics like this, that's beyond me, Gordon. It's something that I would never stoop to. It took a foreign object, a piece of metal bar, to hit me upside the head. Pritchard, you're the lowest man. I'm the king. Anytime you get in that ring with me, mister, you're going to be in for trouble, because I'm not going to stand by, be Mr. Nice Guy, even though I am the king, I am the champion. Nobody treats me like that, Gordon.
You're telling me now that he put a foreign object on his boot.
You saw it.
But you didn't put a foreign object on your
boot. I was straightening my tights to keep up my appearance. I always do that. All I is number one in my book. I wear nice clothes. I keep... Shut up out there! I'm telling what happened. I don't need you to tell me what happened. I was there. I'm the only one that can vouch for exactly what happened. And what happened was, Tom Pritchard, you cheated!
Well, not a very kingly attitude from the, quote, king of wrestling. And maybe the old phrase falls into view here. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. We'll be back. And don't forget, wrestling in Barberville on October 16th. That's Thursday. On Friday night in Knoxville at the Civic Center. On Saturday night, Whitley City, Kentucky. That'll be October 18th. But on the 17th, it will be the Alabama Championship on the line. Before I talk to the champion, Wildcat Wendell Cooley, let's listen to these comments from Jerry Stubbs.
The Tennessee Super Bowl, Gordon, Friday, October 17th. The Knoxville Civic Center is going to be the home of action. 5 championship matches, Jerry Stubbs. And Mr. Perfect, what about yours?
Well, you know, every time I go to Knoxville, Tennessee, that's, you know, it's always a stacked deck against
Uh-oh.
Me. You know, if it's not Wendell Cooley, Brad Armstrong, it's that Phil Rennie ringing the bell out there just to give Brad another chance. Well, everybody saw me knock Brad out. Now, Wendell Cooley, you lucked up and you won the Alabama belt. Well, I'm not going to worry about that because I'm fixing to go to the beach. While you people up there in Knoxville, Tennessee, you ain't got nothing to look at but the trees. Until I come to town, then you can look at me. On Super Bowl night, Wendell Cooley, I'm going to be the Alabama champion, and I'm going to win it in Tennessee, whether you like it or not.
Friday, October 17th, fans, be there. Back to you, Gordon.
I'll tell you what, it's the 1986 Tennessee Super Bowl, and it will be my good friend Wildcat Wendell Cooley against Jerry Stubbs.
That's right. It's going to be a Super Bowl, Gordon. This is going to be the winning team right here. You know, Jerry Stubbs, if you remember correctly, you were the one that took this title and threw it over a bridge, and I didn't cheat you out of this title. I beat you 1, 2, 3 right in the middle, mister. I beat a lot of top talent in this tournament for this Alabama belt, and Jerry Stubbs was one of them. So in Knoxville, Tennessee, we're just going to repeat the process, sir. I'm going to walk away from Knoxville still the Alabama heavyweight champion.
That's going to be on Friday night, October 17th. Make your plans to be there.
Ladies and gentlemen, this tag team event, one fall with a 15-minute time limit, one fall 15. Now in the ring, at a combined weight of 490 pounds, here are the Executioner and the Mongol. The Executioner and the Mad Mongolian. We are awaiting the arrival of their opponents. And there's the music.
I was born, and the saw gathered round. They gazed in wide wonder.
And here they come.
The joy they found.
Ladies and gentlemen, their opponents are Steve Armstrong and the Bullet. Steve Armstrong and the Bullet. One fall, 15.
Bad to the bone. I broke a thousand hearts before I met you. I'll break a thousand more, baby, before I am through. I want to be yours, pretty baby. Yo.
The Bullet and Steve Armstrong going out against El Mongo and the Executioner. One fall Australian tag team match. The Bullet steps out. It'll be Steve Armstrong facing, apparently, the Executioner first off. A set, of course, an Australian tag team event. Don't forget, Ric Flair, NWA World Heavyweight Champion, upcoming shortly.
How about a little gorgeous and luscious joining me out here for you coming facing that group?
All right, the Southeastern Tag Team Champions. Gorgeous Jimmy Golden and luscious Robert Fuller have just joined me. I would assume you're scouting these two men.
Well, you know, we don't have to scout too much. We are the champions. They come around scouting us a lot, Gordon. Yeah. But we heard that you're going to want a little purdy out here during this match. We said, well, I said, Jimmy, let's take some purdy on out there for Gordon. And here we are. But there'll be a little bit we can talk about. You can see right now Steve Armstrong twisting his arm backwards, which is very well illegal, and you and I both know that, Gordon.
That's right. That's exactly right. He's telling you just how the law is laid down, brother, because we know the rules and the regulations. These two punks out here know nothing about wrestling. I'm going to tell you something about that punk, Steve Armstrong. His neck is sore. I can tell you that. It's a wonder that he's getting there at all, because I darn near broke his neck when I dropped him in that pile driver, and his old man ain't any better.
Well, that's the Bullet out there with Steve Armstrong.
Gordon, you got two guys out there on one. I seen him spin his arm one way and turn it around, spin it illegally the back way. They didn't hardly get it done till you saw Bob Armstrong, the Bullet, inflict an illegal karate chop on the man's chest. Hit him and couldn't hit him right in the throat. You can see him in the other corner. That could cross his life, end his career right there. That's an illegal blow. You and I both know it, Gordon.
Full Nelson now on the El Mongol. And
again! Well, where are these referees, man? They don't know the difference in judo and karate and wrestling out there. You're supposed to stop this judo right now.
Well, Mr. Fuller is very upset over the way this match is progressing, but I would say that Steve Armstrong and the Bullet are looking extremely well at this time.
They ain't looking worth nothing, I'm going to tell you that. If they had some competition in there, if they had the luscious one and the gorgeous one in there, they'd be losing to nothing right now, brother. They would be losing from the beginning of the bell to the end like they always have, and you're looking and talking to the real champions, brother.
Well, these gentlemen are indeed the Southeastern Tag Team Champions, but I don't notice you in the ring with them. I notice El Mongol and the Executioner.
Well, you got this nice Mongolian boy, and you got this masked guy in there trying to get his career kicked off with two of these hooligans, backstabbers, like a man's got to wear a mask like this Bullet and that punk son that goes around with him backstabbing every chance he gets to, Gordon. Right now, I'll tell you, it's easy to stand here and talk about a cheater and look at the man like the Bullet in the ring. Hey, I got a question for you. What happened to Peter Pan? Where's Jacob Bell? I got another question for you, too. That Stubby's out there. I'm talking about not Jerry Stubbs, but that Stubby. That boy calls himself now the Continental Champion. Big mouth, mystical Kevin Sullivan. Right. He thinks the mystic himself right into a big problem because nobody comes out here like he did last week and run us down and bring a goon team like that in the area when they know who the men are. Kevin knows who the men are here. Does he have to bring these goons in here face to face with us?
Well, he's talking about, of course, the New Guinea headhunters, who are two of the most awesome competitors that I've seen in action for a long time. Beautiful chop. Beautiful chop into the throat.
Illegal blows like that, Gordon? What do you call it? That's an illegal karate move. He uses it all the time, and the only time it's not successful is when he's in the ring with us.
You know, Mr. Golden, having watched your career for a number of years, I find it rather interesting that you would be so critical of somebody else.
I'm going to tell you something. When you see something good, you point it out. When you see something bad, you point it out. You've been doing it for years, Mr. Soley. Why don't you just face it that me and Mr. Fuller are the best two men? Look at that. Have you ever seen such illegal moves in all your life?
Well, I'll tell you what, there you see.
They raise their hand when you see them double teamed. It's clear night and day, Gordon Soley. What kind of place is Birmingham, Alabama, anyway?
Well, I don't know, but you've got two winners there in the Bullet and in Steve Armstrong. No question about that. And
let's go show him some wins.
Wait a minute. We've got Robert Fuller and Jimmy Golden going toward the ring. I'll tell you what, we can't have that happening. Let's do this. I understand that Kevin Sullivan is in the dressing room with some very, very important comments. Let's go to those comments right now, and then we'll be back.
You know, Tom, the reason why I have you here is because I think you can help understand where I'm coming from, you know, because you were once trained to be a doctor, and I understand the problems you had and why they threw you out of medical school, so I know where your head is at. And you have to understand this. The Tennessee Stud called me this week from Singapore. He went to Ipoh, Malaysia early in the week and met with the Sifu, and he rolled the bones with the man the same way I have. You understand, the Singapore survival match is actually for Robert's and Jimmy's own good. You know, when you don't get something done, in the other part of the world, if you didn't get it done, they may chop up a finger. This way, the boys are just going to get a little beating. And the Tennessee Stud and his infinite wisdom planted in me the weight of the world on his shoulders. So I'm doing this for the betterment of Jimmy and Robert. So when the Stud comes back, he'll see some growth in these boys, not a spiritual breakdown.
Kevin, I know you've been through this with me before. I understand where you're coming from. I've heard all your talk about the Asian way, and maybe Jimmy and Robert have had a little problem. Maybe they didn't quite exactly do what Ron wanted done in the way he should have been done. But when you keep going on about the Asian way and talking about Ron being in Singapore and Malaysia and Bangladesh and lay with the lepers and the snake men and things like this, there's something that I beg to differ with you on. Now, you may have a point on a few things, and when you turned your back on this country, Kevin, you had that right to do that because this is what that country was made up all about. You had the right to go over to Malaysia and Singapore and all these places and do that thing.
But I don't want to get in the middle of you and the Tennessee Studs arguments here, because I really don't have anything to do with it. I think you ought to settle that by yourself, which I'm sure you will. Now, as far as Robert and Jimmy go in the Singapore survival match, I think it's going to remain to be seen. And again, Ron Fuller will have his way done one way or another. I don't want to get in the middle of this, Kevin.
Well, not getting in the middle, let me explain something, Tom Pritchard. You said about that I turned my back, and what you're saying is that your beliefs are better than my beliefs. You see, I've been to temples where the people have been there for 2,500 years. I've been to temples where people chant. I have been with the lepers, just like the Tennessee Stud has. Now, it's real clear, Tom Pritchard, if you're not with me in the Stud, you're against us.
I never said that.
This NWA World Heavyweight Championship match in progress now. It's been going on for about the last 6 minutes. Ric Flair in the green trunks, the NWA World Heavyweight Champion. Ric Flair out of the University of Minnesota. By the way, let's say a special hello to all of the folks joining us at KTMA in Minneapolis. My old hometown. Ric Flair lived there for a number of years and now makes his home in Charlotte, North Carolina. He's in the green trunks. Wildcat Wendell Cooley out of Texas catches the world champion in a good, beautiful high hip toss. Another high hip toss. Cooley looking extremely well. Cooley, who has been training on the beaches of Pensacola. High backdrop now by Wildcat Wendell Cooley, and Ric Flair, the champion, slips outside the ring. Lumbar section of his back, paining him, obviously. I want to say hi to George and Gay Swenson up in St. Louis Park. Also a special hello to Dale Morrow, Sherry Mullenix, Sarah Nix, Emery McGuff, and John Hall in North Alabama. People all over the country watching this match now between Ric Flair and the green trunks, the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, and Wildcat Wendell Cooley out of Texas. Flair, a jet setter, drives the knee to the midsection of Cooley. Flair, four times World Heavyweight Champion, one of the very, very few men in professional wrestling ever to achieve that stature. And Flair drives the knee into the prefrontal lobe of Wildcat Wendell Cooley. A chop into the throat of Cooley. Flair catches him again, side headlock, then drives a fist into the face of Cooley. Cooley could be in trouble here. Flair has great finesse as a champion, but there are times when Mr. Flair does not pay any attention to the rules and regulations. He is about as tough as you come as a world champion. Cooley powers out. Again, Cooley gets that shoulder off. Flair going for an outside cradle. Flair, of course, at one time the Minnesota State amateur heavyweight champion. Good move by Cooley. Cooley, a single leg pickup. He goes for the spinning toe hold. Now he's going for the figure four. Cooley has the figure four. And this capacity crowd at Coutwell Auditorium in Birmingham, Alabama, going absolutely berserk now as Cooley has got the figure four. And that is a hold that has been patented by Ric Flair. And so Cooley comes with a surprise. Cooley coming with a real surprise. We're going to have to break away here in just a moment or two for a commercial message and a special interview. And in the event of a pinfall or a submission hold while we're away, we'll bring that to you on instant replay. But we will be returning with this NWA World Heavyweight Championship right after we pause for these messages.
Friday, the Tennessee Super Bowl, October 17th, a big Friday night in Knoxville. Southeastern Tag Team Championship, Robert Fuller and Jimmy Golden Flash with the Bullet and Steve Armstrong. Continental title, Mystic Kelvin Sullivan takes on Brad Armstrong. Southeastern title, Adrian Street against Hustler Rip Rogers. It'll be the Alabama title, Wendell Cooley against Jerry Stubbs. U.S. Junior title, Tim Hoyer against Roy Lee Welch. John Sexton against Dr. Tom. Knoxville, be there.
Talk about three great nights of wrestling competition. You can hear the excitement right now. That'll be in Barberville on October 16th, Thursday night. Friday night, the 17th, in Knoxville at the 86th Tennessee Super Bowl of Wrestling. And then, of course, on the 18th, Saturday night in Whitley, Kentucky, a great night of wrestling competition. Before I talk to these two men who are going after the Southeastern Tag Team Championship, Freddie Miller has the champions on hand.
Talk about the Tennessee Super Bowl, fans. Friday, October 17th, the Civic Coliseum in Knoxville, Tennessee. Five championship matches, eight big matches on the card. We got Robert Fuller and Jimmy Golden. Your titles are on the line in Knoxville.
Back on the make it is what I'm telling you. I'm talking about that rat walking around here talking who getting a man's job done. Look at the fact of the matter right here, baby. Look what I'm slapping in the face of tag team championship. Everywhere we go, single or otherwise, we're champions, baby. We're number one. We signify number one. You get in our way, punk, and you'll find that out. Knoxville's our town. Punk Stevie goes down.
The New Guinea Headhunters making their first appearance, but more importantly, the Southeastern Tag Team Championship.
You know, everybody's excited about the 86 Tennessee Super Bowl, but nobody more excited than Steve Armstrong and the Bullet, because we've got a chance at the Southeastern Tag Team Championships. A lot of titles on the line that night, a lot of new wrestlers in the area, one of the biggest nights in Knoxville history, and brother, I hope we make history by winning those tag team titles right there in Knoxville on Friday night.
Neither man able to score a pinfall or a submission hold while we were away. The action continues in the ring, so let's go back to the ring. Wildcat Wendell Cooley moving against the NWA World Heavyweight Champion Ric Flair. Right now, Cooley pressing that advantage. Next week, here on Southeastern Continental Championship Wrestling, Ron Fuller returns, the Tennessee Stud. Plus, you'll be seeing a Southeastern Tag Team Championship match. Gorgeous Jimmy Golden and luscious Robert Fuller going up against the Bullet and Steve Armstrong. One sad note we'd like to comment in passing. Gene Gordon, one of the outstanding wrestling photographers and reporters in the nation, unfortunately passed away during this past week. We extend our sympathies to his family. Now, back to the action in the ring. Wildcat Wendell Cooley catches Ric Flair as Flair lashed out with a right foot. And now it is Flair turning the advantage around. A judo chop into the throat. Another chop, and Wildcat Wendell Cooley fires back. What a tremendous battle between these two men. Wildcat Wendell Cooley challenging the NWA World Heavyweight Champion Ric Flair in the green trunks. Flair down to one knee. Cooley dumped through the ring ropes. And so it is Cooley in a lot of trouble. Once again, we'd like to remind you, don't forget, next week it will be the Southeastern Tag Team Championship match. Robert Fuller and Jimmy Golden against the Bullet and Steve Armstrong. The Tennessee Stud returns. And our time is rapidly running out on this NWA World Heavyweight Championship match. Wildcat Wendell Cooley against Ric Flair, four times NWA champion. Till next week, Gordon Solie saying so long.